Hello and welcome to this video series on the Power BI Adoption Framework, which is about empowering every decision maker. I'm Manu.
And I'm Paul.
And in this video, we'll provide an overview of the series. Power BI is a great self-service BI tool, and it's helping hundreds of thousands of organizations to drive a data-driven culture. Having said that, self-service BI is one of the most challenging aspects of BI, because it requires a change in people, processes, and technology. This framework provides a wrapper around Power BI, which helps in understanding various aspects of adoption, including the challenges that you may face, and provides a structured approach for driving adoption of self-service BI. With the amount of data that's available today, people can be a lot more productive if they're able to consume data quickly and are able to make informed decisions. Having said that, data culture is not a tool. It is a change in mindsets and behaviors and requires an approach that focuses on managing this change. One of the key reasons why our customers want to focus on Power BI adoption is that BI has traditionally been delivered via a waterfall methodology, where it takes months, if not years, to develop a solution. And people have developed that mindset. Power BI challenges that and requires a change in the mindset, because Power BI really enables Agile BI. Another common reason for customers to adopt a self-service BI culture is that they have a lot of legacy tools that have been developed over the years by IT, business, and third parties. And they're living with these tools because IT teams have a limited bandwidth. These solutions are typically very expensive to support and maintain. The idea of making people capable of developing their own solutions and replacing those legacy tools is very attractive to our customers. Return on investment for IT transformation is dependent on behavior change, and we all know that behavior change is discretionary. Deployment and activation of IT tools is typically achieved because it's within the control of the project team. However, adoption and proficiency are usually poorly achieved or not done at all because they are directly proportionate to the value that the individuals see in consuming that solution. And whose responsibility is it after all? Adoption in IT is not very different from other spheres of our life. Adoption happens if the individual sees ongoing value in using the product or service. And that's a good thing because once someone can see value in something, they will be able to do things differently. It's like buying toys for my son. I can buy them, hoping that he'll continuously entertain himself with them, but the charm of a new toy normally disappears within a few minutes. There are very few toys that continue to excite him beyond the first 5 minutes. A good example is a bicycle. It's different from a lot of other toys because it allows him to experience life differently. In fact, more than the bicycle, it's the experiences that it can facilitate. It's the same with technology. It's not about the tool, it's about what the tool allows you to do differently. The way people adopt tools is by going through 4 stages of adoption. At the first stage, people are aware of the product and its features. In case of Power BI, this could be through a presentation from Microsoft or a partner. The next stage comes when people understand the benefits of the product and its features. And this could be through a more detailed workshop or some research that they do. It's about creating momentum at this stage. People get enabled when they learn to use the product and its features, and this could be via trainings or self-exploration. And finally, people adopt the product when they see ongoing value in the product and use it regularly. It is a progression, and it's easy to lose interest at any point, so the value add should be significant enough to keep people inspired. If you want to drive change in people's behavior by adopting a data-driven culture, then you can set yourselves up for success by accepting that this change will challenge very deeply entrenched behaviors and developing a plan which will make this journey smooth, exciting, and rewarding for your employees. We thought we'd provide a bit of background of the journey that we've been through and why we are creating this video series. We saw a lot of people getting energized when they saw Power BI demos, and when it came to getting access to Power BI and using it regularly, it was easy for a few, But for the vast majority, there were a few steps that needed to be taken before people could actually start using Power BI. Our customers started asking for help with those steps, which were wider considerations around adopting Power BI. So we thought, let's identify these steps and develop a framework that helps our customers to accelerate the rollout of Power BI with minimal governance and high confidence. When we started working with customers to develop this framework for Power BI adoption, we leveraged the content from our amazing white papers. The white paper format wasn't suitable for interactive discussions, so we developed a set of slides based on these white papers by putting them into context of the various stages of adoption that we discussed earlier. We also worked closely with the Power BI product group to align with the vision of the Power BI product team and incorporate feedback from a range of customers. We have an internal community at Microsoft called BI Champs. In this community, we collaborate to answer challenging customer or partner queries, so we incorporated that learning into the slides as well. Being Power BI geeks ourselves, we also created a word cloud on this mailbox to identify the areas that were top of mind for customers and partners. Microsoft has had a viral adoption of Power BI over the last few years. So we also spoke with the team that helped with the rollout of Power BI at Microsoft and captured their learning. Finally, as we worked with customers and partners, we captured their feedback along the way and kept revising this content. So this framework has evolved over the last 3.5 years with feedback from various channels, and there was an increasing demand to make it available publicly in an easily accessible format. And we thought that a video series will be the most accessible method for customers and partners across the globe. Our intention is that you can either run through this content yourself to develop an adoption plan and establish a center of excellence for your organization, or you can work with a partner who can help you do the same. We spoke with a lot of our customers to understand the key factors that influence the adoption of Power BI. These are the factors that can be the key enablers or blockers for adoption, and our most successful customers have them covered in some way, shape, or form. The feedback from customers was in 3 key areas. The first one was about having a clear BI strategy, which is primarily provided by the leadership team. The second area is around addressing technical issues, and these issues could be related to the customer's setup or could be related to Power BI as a product. The third key area is planning, and this is the one where the results are directly proportionate to the amount of effort that goes in. Imagine a ship without a captain. That's the situation that can arise from not having executive sponsorship for Power BI adoption. Because Power BI adoption in itself is not typically an organizational goal. The goal is to drive a data-driven culture, and if the company's leadership has that vision, then they can set direction, guide the whole process, appoint people to manage the process, provide necessary funding, and ensure commitment and progress. Compliance, security, and governance are very important topics in context of any tool that enables self-service BI. So this is an extremely important topic for our customers. Having control of these areas increases everyone's confidence and allows everyone to focus on getting value out of their data. And this is where organizations that start with clear BI scenarios that provide information that people need to make decisions in their day job can expect almost instant adoption. When I think about data quality, I get reminded of the quote, "Perfection is the enemy of good." Every organization wants that their data should be in the perfect shape and there should be only one version of the truth. While this is possible for some solutions, it's usually quite difficult to get that perfect world situation for all data sets, as it's always a moving target. The key with data quality is to find the right balance between control and agility, and organizations that find that balance are able to accelerate their adoption of Power BI. While Power BI is a cloud-based service, the cloud elements of the service require a certain level of administration, and there are some components that can be installed on-premises, for example, the Power BI desktop tool or an on-premises gateway. It's good to have a strategy for installing and updating these tools upfront so that the rollout of Power BI happens smoothly. Power BI's capabilities are improving at an amazing speed. Having said that, There are scenarios where there are product gaps, and Power BI may not yet have certain capabilities that your organization needs. While we try to listen to our customers through various channels and incorporate these new capabilities as quickly as possible, one of the key strengths of the Microsoft stack is that we have multiple tools that integrate very well with Power BI. So sometimes it's a matter of identifying a different way of achieving the same outcome using a set of tools rather than Power BI on its own. Understanding the different profiles of the users, their technical know-how, the organization's culture, maturity, and diversity are really important for the rollout and adoption of Power BI. Because if you're mindful of these important elements which are specific to each organization, you can develop an adoption plan that will be effective for that particular organization. As an example, the technical profile of users in a tech company would be very different from a retail organization. Programmatically designing the adoption plan can help you plan for self-service BI success, and this is the key focus of this whole series. Center of excellence is an interesting concept. There are various interpretations of the concept. However, the common principles are that it includes representatives from across the business who are champions for driving a data-driven culture, and they develop ways of working to ensure consistency and maintainability while ensuring that security and compliance are in everyone's mind. A center of excellence can put a very positive spin on the whole journey and can ensure that consistent progress is made. We've seen examples where a center of excellence has led to viral adoption of Power BI, so we would highly recommend that you consider developing one. This framework has a strong focus on all of these topics, so we'll discuss them in a lot more detail in subsequent videos.
We've broken Power BI adoption into three phases. Envision, where the aim is to prove the value of Power BI to a core group of people. Onboard, we will implement that first solution and plan how you'll roll out across your organization. And drive value, we will roll out and encourage others to use Power BI. Throughout this series, we will cover these areas in detail, from the envisioning phase, where we'll talk about why you need an executive sponsor and how you can educate them about the values of Power BI and self-service BI. We'll talk about how to identify Power BI champions in the business, the benefits of training this pilot team during the envisioning, and provide recommendations on the initial proof of value that you can create to demonstrate Power BI to your organization using your data. For the onboarding phase, we focus on how to select that initial pilot to further prove the value, how to run the adoption workshop, which helps you to decide on governance, service management, security, rollout, and support. We talk about what you need to consider about data management, and we will provide recommendations on how to implement that first solution and what to do next. Lastly, with Drive Value, we cover how and why to build a Centre of Excellence team, provide suggestions around how you can internally market the solutions that you're creating. We outline our definition of the different types of users and what training we recommend for them, and how you can support all of this by building a community inside your organisation. In terms of the long-term engagement model, the intention with self-service BI is to enable individuals to create their own solutions, but this will happen in stages. So at the initial stages, IT and partners could be heavily involved to lay the foundations for self-service BI and deliver corporate BI solutions. At the next stage, IT and partners could be supporting business teams while they develop their own solutions, and they can develop relatively complex solutions as well. At the final stage, the intention is that the business users will be able to support each other in developing solutions, so IT and partners will primarily provide guidance and develop advanced solutions. When running through the adoption framework for the first time, this tends to start with a workshop, whereby you will discuss all of the content covered in this series. This tends to be a 2 to 3 day workshop, depending on the current level of understanding of Power BI and the current journey towards self-service BI, typically based on the maturity of data availability throughout your business. During the workshop, many key configuration decisions will be made, along with who will own it and who will do it. All of this needs to be documented. This will help with why a decision was made, as well as give everyone an opportunity to have an input on these decisions. It is unlikely you will manage to get all of the relevant decisions made and owners agreed in the initial workshop, so there will be a round of follow-up discussions and refinements of decisions and documentation. Once this has all been done, a plan for rollout and further iterations should be clearly established to ensure everyone gets the right level of access and everyone can start benefiting from the rich functionality of Power BI. During this series, we will provide a key set of questions to ask and decide upon, with a recommendation that you document these so everyone knows what to do, why, and who will do it. These questions fit into two categories. The first being with who will take ownership and responsibility for a part of Power BI. For example, who will administer the Power BI service or who will communicate the rollout plan. The second set of questions aims to capture specific tasks, such as automatic license assignment or configuring a Teams channel to create a Power BI community. Alongside all of these videos, we also provide all of the presentations used in the description below the video, along with a sample output document. The intention is that you watch this series and run the workshop inside your or your customer's organization. Thanks for listening, and if you have any feedback or questions, please leave a comment down below. See you in the next one.